Six, five, four, three, two, one. Now live.
89.5 WSKB.
From the campus of Westfield State University, this is 89.5 FM, WSKB, Westfield.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by Westfield Bank. For more than 160 years, Westfield Bank has been an important community presence and commercial leader in the Pioneer Valley. With convenient full banking services in Westfield, West Springfield, East Longmeadow, Agawam, Feeding Hills, Springfield, Southwick, as well as Enfield and Granby, Connecticut, visit us on the web at westfieldbank.org.
Well, good morning, Greater Westfield, and of course the world on WSKB.org. It's really good to be back here after a little hiatus from the studio.
A little hiatus?
Just a little hiatus from the studio.
Your real job's been keeping you on a big hiatus.
Well, it's far from a hiatus. It's just a diversion, I think, might be more accurately described. But
You've been busy.
I've been busy. Yeah, that kind of thing.
The Kenny button.
Thank you for Kenny's big X buzzer.
The Kenny button.
Yeah. I
don't push the shiny button.
Okay. Wait, what's the little red button on the shifter, right? Isn't that the ejector in James Bond's car?
Yeah, but then they had a whole Ren and Stimpy episode. Don't push the shiny red button.
Ah.
Nobody knows what the shiny red button will do. That irresistible red button. Don't push the button. It was an episode called Space Madness.
Aha. Sten and Rimpy. That was one
Ren
of those.
Ren and Stimpy.
Sten and Rimpy.
Okay.
That was one of those shows that we watched while drinking lots of adult beverages back in the day.
Yes.
Yeah. You had to in order to put up with it. It's almost as bad as SpongeBob is today. Only I think at least Ren and Stimpy had a little more adult humor in it. They're both off the wall. But anyway, I don't know why we went there. This is J-Pag Luca. That's
because you
Pete
had
Coles.
To push the shiny red button.
Yeah, that's Pete Coles on the other side of the window over there. There is a strange green hue behind me, and actually, you folks can, if you're watching on television, can see it on the table. Ah, there it is. Yeah, our wall behind us has been
painted
a chroma key green. Is there an official name for that color?
That's chroma key green is the actual name of the color.
Ah, I it's nice to guess right once in a while. But we have to make some other adjustments around the studio because of that, because it's, well, let's see, over here, it's on the table, and it's just because
well,
it's
it always happened, but you didn't notice as much because it was blue.
Well, okay.
That happened before, too.
Yeah, sometimes it would.
No, it happened a lot.
What's on there? Let me see. What's up here, over here? Oh, that's the chair doing the same thing.
Yeah.
Oh my. Well, it's going to be an interesting. It's going to be an interesting thing as we work.
I don't have $70,000 for an Ultimat.
No, I actually black gaffs tape on might do the trick on the chair anyway.
I think I'm getting new chairs anyways.
Okay. Well.
Those chairs are just about shot.
Get some that are not shiny.
Well, I'm not getting ones with mesh.
Okay.
The mesh is gone.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm getting a quote. I'm getting the heavy duty chairs so they'll last a little longer. And it's gonna be about $4,000 for new chairs.
Oh my.
Yeah, those
chairs ain't cheap.
No.
Good chairs ain't cheap.
Correct.
You can get cheap chairs that aren't good.
Right. Those chairs weren't that cheap either.
Yeah.
We'll see if somebody can fix them. We'll just use them maybe across the hall in the shop.
Yeah. So what have you been up to over the last month or so? Let's catch up a little bit.
I did 4 weeks of Babe Ruth baseball and softball.
Now, that was not here in the area, though.
No, that was in Jensen Beach, Florida.
Uh-huh.
I was actually responsible. Well, now I'm responsible for six parks and 17 fields.
All down there?
No, there's two in New Jersey. There
no
was
kidding.
Three in Ocala, Florida, which is 2-3 hours north of where I was at. I had Citrus Grove, I had three fields. I had Halpatioki Park, I had three fields. Pineapple Park, I had three fields. And Sailfish Park in Stuart, Florida, I had two fields.
You're just becoming a new age Rune Arledge, you know, here.
It wasn't that. Well, it was just a single camera like we did at Cross Street. Because we didn't have the staff wasn't sustainable for multiple cameras on each field.
Yeah.
So we did single camera with that really wide look where people could see everything. And that goes over pretty well.
Yeah, this is the one behind the backstop.
Or correct. On the backstop. Yeah. Yep. So we did that down there. Softball went pretty smooth. Baseball, there was somebody new kind of running the show. We love her dearly. She was young and inexperienced, and she was kind of out of her depth. And baseball went a little rough on the recording side.
But that's how you learn.
Right.
You know.
But we tried to help her, and she just – somehow she made things worse. We tried to help her, and then she made things worse, and it wasn't communicating. And
I won't say that I've never done something and not made things a little – worser.
Right, and she and we love her dearly. That's the thing. She's a great person. We love her dearly, but she was put out of her depth, I think.
Yeah. So, hey, it's stuff like that happens, and then you're better the next time. You learn from it.
I hope so.
Yeah.
I hope so.
So we have a lot of stuff coming up. We're playing catch up this summer for all the stuff that we weren't able to do last year. We've already had a couple of concerts. Of course, the downtown concerts by Artworks over by
Mina's Wine and Spirits.
Yes, they've been great. And I do have to mention that the folks that are putting the old Bentley Billiards building, which is, I think they're calling it Lamson Square. It's going to be a multi-use place. But for the first show out there, they came out and somehow got interested in what Probe was doing in the field for the upcoming Friday night. So Wednesday, he kind of laid them out. Hey, here's what we do. We're going to be doing it for the next number of Fridays. And all of a sudden, by Friday afternoon, a stage was built.
I know, huh? The guys built the stage for it?
Yeah, with a nice little cover over it in case of inclement weather. And it was really it was nicely done. It was a cool, perfect size for that space, and you know he's had between 100 and 200 people there every Friday night.
I noticed that though, attendance has been so much better now than it was in years past.
Well, first of all, people were itching to get out anywhere for anything, and you know it's been fun. The stage helps. We've had some barbecue there some nights that was wonderful.
Rick Barry's been slinging the White Lion.
Slinging the White Lion, yep. Yeah, White Lion Brewery's been helping out. And also, I've been lucky enough to be part of the Westfield on Weekends series out behind the Boys and Girls Club. We had Queen Band.
You discount yourself. You were the one that you and Jason Poulin got it going as a paid show. And then when things kind of opened up, Wild said, "Hey, we can't do anything on the green. It's too late to organize that. Can we work with you guys and turn that into a free show?"
Well, and
that's the evolution of it.
A lot of good things came together. You know, first of all, as soon as we saw the world was opening up again, and we weren't going to get and everybody was doing free concerts everywhere. So even though we were bringing in a lot of great acts there, and expensive ones. We knew we weren't going to be able to charge what we had to cover the costs. We were very, very, very lucky that a lot of sponsors stepped up to help fill that gap. So I'm grateful, and Jason is a big part of that. He had the contacts, he had the time, the wherewithal to get out there and search out the sponsors. So hats off to Jason for a lot of hard work to get that done. So although, not all the costs were covered, we're still trying to make a little bit to give back to not only Westfield on Weekends, but Kiwanis. And you can help. If you want to come down, make a donation to the concerts. Those that are donating, and in fact, those that had bought tickets before we went free are also being ushered down to
VIP,
the VIP section, the front section of the field in front of the stage. You'll get essentially VIP seats to the concerts. So we encourage you to go out to westfieldlivemusic.com. And you can find out all you need to know about how to make donations. And you can do that right on site, too. Mm-hmm. You come in, you can go to General Admission.
Rob Goff was talking about that.
Or down to General, or down to the I Donated section. And and I'll tell you what, I'll bet you a rough estimate is between 1,500 and 2,000 people at the Queen show.
I saw pictures and video. It looked like more than that.
Yeah, that's a conservative estimate. And I hope to do the same for the next one. And in addition to the show, one of the things that happened, it was kind of a last minute, gee, what a great idea, can we make it happen thing. Western Mass Small Business organized, I think, like 50 vendors to come in with their little tents and all around the perimeter of the field, you know, of the concert audience area, all around the perimeter, we had a ring, essentially, of vendors, like craft show stuff. And so great small vendors, great businesses from all over Western Massachusetts. It was cool. And we're going to do that again for the next three shows. The next one is coming up August 28th.
Correct. Right after the Whip City Brew Fest.
Right. So leave the Brew Fest and wander over behind the Boys and Girls Club, and you're going to find us finishing setting up for a show, and the gates open at 5, so you'll be able to come in and wander the vendors, and our first act goes on at 6:45, and the band, which is a big 80s dance party with Category 5, and they're out of Pennsylvania. A great 80s band. They're one of these chameleons bands that'll, you know, what do you want to hear? And they put the show together. So that's put together with a friend of mine, Kathy Wagner. She's from Panzeiler Entertainment. And she's out of New Jersey. I've worked with her for many, many years. And the next show coming up is September 25th. And frankly, that's the one I'm looking forward to the most, because the band is called Jingo, and they are a Santana tribute band. And if you look at the link from westfieldlivemusic.com, unbelievable. You just close your eyes. Even if you watch these guys, the guitar, the percussion, the keyboards, it's Santana. And I can't tell you how much I'm looking forward to that. I've never seen Santana live, so this is my best opportunity to do that, and it's kind of cool because I get to work behind the scenes and help make it happen. Finally, in October 16th, we'll have Pumpkin Fest. I keep wanting to say Oktoberfest. We'll have Pumpkin Fest out there behind the Boys and Girls Club, and it's going to be all the things that Pumpkin Fest has ever been, plus another trip back in time to great rock and roll from the 60s to the 90s with Rewind to Vinyl. So it's just great stuff. By the way, the openers for all of these bands are kids from the Boys and Girls Club arts program. They have a music program that is unbelievable. Matty Bissell opened for Queen.
He is currently auditioning on Broadway.
Is he really?
He got a second callback.
He did. I was wondering how that was going to go.
Yeah, his dad texted me. I'm friends with his dad.
Yeah.
And he said he got a callback. He was in New York City earlier this week, I believe.
No kidding.
Yep.
Because I know he's working, he's doing something with the Exit 6 players.
Yeah,
which
this
is,
could be a Broadway gig.
But I would think that would trump Exit 6. But he's got an incredible voice. We were doing rehearsals.
And his sister had a really good voice, too.
Yes, yes.
She has gone behind the scenes and is now into doing makeup and stuff like that for theater.
So many of us, so we love the world of entertainment. And while she had a great, and probably still has a great voice, haven't heard her sing in a long time, but I started singing when I was young, and I just certainly don't know whether I had even a shot at the talent, but I loved the business. I loved working behind the scenes, helping to produce the shows, lighting, sound, whatever it took. So I feel I'm very,
I never
very
got out
lucky.
Of lighting and sound space. I was horrible at singing and things like that.
Yeah, well, so my mom could play the piano. My daughter could play the flute. My dad played football. My son played football. I just skipped everything in the middle. So I got nothing. So that's what's been going on around here in Westfield. Lots coming up. Keep an eye on this. This is still, there's still some great great music coming up, and we're starting to look into the winter.
Brewfest
season.
Has a good music lineup
Run down Brewfest before we break here.
So we have the rock duo We have a 10-piece band coming in as our middle set, kind of like the peak time for Brewfest.
Yeah.
And they're out of the East Hampton, Northampton area, and they're kind of an Afro jazz fusion funk band.
That's cool.
Scare the crap out of me. 10 pieces. I still don't know how the hell I'm going to do that one, especially since Kenny's not going to be here. He's going to be in Vegas, the rat. I was like, I need a roadie.
You know who to use is reach out to Rick Barry.
Yeah, Rick is running the thing, okay. So he might be busy.
Well, okay, but Rick has been a big help to us when I need an extra stagehand.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. I said, Rick, I might need you for setup. Maybe if we can get, I got to get the band in there early, the 10-piece, and have them set, and then work around them because they're the biggest set.
Yeah, that's a good call.
And I haven't heard back from the guy yet, but then we have the Charlie Galvin band. It's going to be a trio, I think.
Yeah, I ran into Charlie Galvin's drummer the other night. He was he's drumming for a band called the 60s Experience, who they're picking up some
gigs here.
Gigs around here. Where did we see him? Oh, up at East Mountain. So it was a good night.
Yeah, so those are our three for that. They're all playing for free, so feel free to give tips.
Yeah, please.
And I'm making a donation to the Children's Museum. The mug that you see here, I have some that are specially decorated for the performers with Whip City Brewfest logos.
So Brewfest is a benefit for?
The Amelia Park Children's Museum.
And it's going to happen?
August 28th from noon to 5.
And it will be where?
Traditionally it was in the Westfield News lot, but that building has been sold and the lot is not big enough. But the old dirt lot that was right on the other side of the wall from Levesque, sandwiched between
towards the Athenaeum.
Yeah, between the Westfield News building and the Berkshire Bank.
There, yeah.
Right. So that lot was paved. And the city has allowed us to use that lot for the Brewfest.
Yeah, hats off to the city of Westfield. They have made it very easy for those of us in the arts world that want to do things on city property. They've just bent over backwards. We still have to follow the rules because there are a lot of them, but when you do that, it's like, hey, I'm playing in somebody else's backyard and they're letting us do this. Just, we'd like to make sure we pick up afterwards. So, I love that people come in. And after our concert behind the Boys and Girls Club, I've got to say, people picked up after themselves. It could have been a big mess with 2,000 people out there. And they did. They picked up. The Westfield Police Department was a huge help in the logistics and helping us control things.
Going forward, this is going to be tougher doing these events because when the state passed a police reform law, because of the amount of training required now for police reform and sensitivity and all that junk, it's going to be very tough. It's going to be impossible for them to maintain an auxiliary force. Most departments have already gotten rid of it. And to that end, they've also gotten rid of their part-time reserve force too, because the amount of training, you might as well just make them full-time.
Yeah, well,
it's going to be tough going forward doing events.
Yeah, we'll find ways to work with them to make that happen. From them providing some manpower from the auxiliary, and most of them were volunteers.
They are all volunteers, yeah.
And the logistics support. We says, hey, we want to do this. What do we need to be aware of? And we sit down and this is like weeks and months before the event.
Months in advance, yeah, sure.
Yeah, and we talk about that. The CERT fund, or the CERT organization here in town. What's the CERT stand for?
Community Emergency Response Team.
That's it, yeah. Those folks have been great, and they've been involved in this. So, getting input from all of them in advance is huge in making sure we have a safe event. And, are we going to, if anything goes wrong, or we're mostly ready for it. I want to say,
you have a good plan.
Yeah, we do. And that's huge. It really is. I feel good. And again, that's hats off to Jason Poland for helping to organize all of that. He happens to be on the CERT committee and therefore a contact with all of those important organizations. So, Jason, thank you for all of your hard work. We're not done yet. We've got a lot of fun in front of us, and I hope the folks in Greater Westfield are able to come out and take advantage of that. Hey, let's take a break and come back on the other side, and we'll talk about maybe taking a trip back into old-time radio.
I have information, please. Alfred Hitchcock.
Ooh, we haven't done a good Alfred Hitchcock in a long time.
But this isn't Alfred Hitchcock. I think it's an interview with Alfred Hitchcock.
Really?
The name of the show is called Information, Please.
Now, that sounds interesting. And he's one of those people that has a lot of dry humor.
Yes.
Yes. This is JPEG Luca. That's Pete Coles. This is JP's Talk About Town. JP's Old Time Radio is right around the corner.
Support for community radio on WSKB provided by Westfield Electroplating. Employing over 140 skilled platers, painters, and technicians, Westfield Electroplating was founded in 1946 and was the first company in the country to achieve National Aerospace and Defense Contractor Program accreditation, proudly maintaining that status for over a decade. Westfield Electroplating provides over 50 quality finishes to meet your corrosion, cosmetic, or performance needs. On the web at www.westfieldplating.com or 413-568-3716. Westfield Electroplating, putting the finishing touches on technology.
I'm Mark Auerbach. Join me every Friday at 8 a.m. for Artspeed, where you'll meet interesting actors, directors, designers, and musicians here in Western New England.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
The best tunes of all move to Carnegie Hall. Yes, the best tunes of all move to Carnegie Hall.
The best tunes of all move to Carnegie Hall. Yes, the best tunes of all move to Carnegie Hall.
It's half past 8.
It's 8:30 New York time. Time to wake up America and stump the experts. Each week at this time, Lucky Strike acts as referee in a contest of wits between the Information Please experts and our coast-to-coast listening audience. You provide the questions and our experts try to answer them. Remember, for every question used, Lucky Strike will give you not only $10 in war stamps, but a set of the 12-volume Britannica Junior Encyclopedia. If the question is muff, you get the Junior Britannica plus a $50 war bond plus a 24-volume set of the regular Encyclopedia Britannica.
The best tunes of all move to Carnegie Hall. Yes, the best tunes of all move to Carnegie Hall.
Send your questions to Information Please, 480 Lexington Avenue, New York City. If our editorial staff edits your questions a bit, don't fret over it. In case of similarity, we'll have to be sole judge of who shall be paid. And all questions become the property of Information Please.
The best tunes of all move to Carnegie Hall. Yes, the best tunes of all move to Carnegie Hall.
And now light up a lucky strike as I present our master of ceremonies, book reviewer of the New Yorker magazine, Clifton Fadiman. Mr. Fadiman.
Thank you, Mr. Clark. Ladies and gentlemen, spontaneous and unrehearsed, as usual, Information Please brings its trio of regulars, Oscar Levant, Franklin P. Adams, and John Kieran, now presiding over a daily column in the New York Sun and other papers, and as its guest, that great Hollywood master, Alfred Hitchcock, whose new picture, Shadow of a Doubt, is thrilling large audiences now on Broadway. Now we're going to begin with a question from N. Ogintz of Detroit. What happened to a character, whether of fact or fiction, because of lying? He or she lied and something happened to him or her. Who was that and what did happen? Mr. Adams.
Well, it might have been Bluebeard's wife.
Did she lie?
She lied. Said she wasn't in that there closet.
As a matter of fact, well, what did happen to her as a result of it?
I think it there was some mortality connected with it.
No, as a matter of fact, she got away with it, didn't she? Wasn't she saved?
As I recollect, she was saved, but she was in trouble. She was threatened.
Well, you're the master of threats, Mr. Hitchcock. What did happen to Bluebeard's wife, remember?
Which one?
I didn't know that your acquaintance was as wide as that. Mr. Levant?
She wound up in a ballet last year. Bluebeard's wife, it was a ballet.
That's that on her. All right. I was thinking of a character from the Bible that
yes.
Mr.
Peter lied twice, then went out and wept bitterly.
Yes, there is one. And who, Mr.
Ananias.
Ananias. What happened to him?
I don't know.
Would you like me to tell you?
Yes.
For the same money?
Yes.
He was struck dead because he lied unto God. And he was struck dead. What happened to Pinocchio, Mr. Levant?
He changed into a semi-animal form, a complete peculiar animal. I have at home my baby's room. I don't know. What is that? Bambi?
I don't know. Ask your baby. I'm sure she reads. Pinocchio's nose grew longer with each lie that he told. Now, what happened to a character, fact or fiction, because he or she pried? We've had lying. Let's have prying now. Mr. Kieran.
Well, Alice in Wonderland cried. A mouse cried in Alice.
Not cried. Pried. P-R-Y-E-D.
No, I said cried. I'm
prying. Mr. Hitchcock.
Peeping Tom.
Peeping Tom? What happened to him?
Well, when Lady Godiva rode through Coventry.
Yes.
And Tom what? I don't know what happened to him.
He got his eyes stuck out.
Yes. He was struck blind. That's quite right. And, matter of fact, Mr. Adams, your first answer would have been correct for this one. Bluebeard's wife cried. Her name, by the way, in case you care to collect these things, was Fatima.
Fatima W. Bluebeard.
Fatima W. Bluebeard, yes. Her life was saved because she cried. How about it, Mr. Hitchcock?
Has that anything to do with pride goeth before a fall?
Oh, that's Adams' specialty. You can't take that away from Adams. He needs this job.
Pride goeth before understanding and a haughty spirit before a fall.
Hey, that's wonderful. The Reverend Frank T. Adams. I never suspected it of you, Frank. How about a character to whom something happened because he or she whied? Now, that's W-H-Y-E-D. Did too much whying. In other words, asked why too
often. Fanny Bryce and Snooks.
That's right, Mr. Levant. Very good. And what happens to Fanny Bryce?
Well, if we can't answer her why, she'll get an encyclopedia. I don't know. She just says, why, Daddy? And,
yeah, that's right.
And then they renewed for 26 more weeks.
Ah, yeah, but not before she gets what?
What happens? A piece of candy.
No, just the opposite.
She doesn't get a piece of candy.
That's right. She gets spanked. She gets a spanking almost every week. How about this one? From Francis D. Moore of Brookline, Massachusetts. I think this will appeal to you particularly, Mr. Hitchcock, because as I understand it, you're quite an epicure. Or do you deny the soft impeachment? What part of an animal's anatomy is served when you eat the following thing? Suppose you're eating tripe.
That's the inner lining of the stomach.
Yes. Is it any good?
I've never tasted it.
You never have cared for it?
With plenty of stuff on, you can hardly notice it.
The inner lining of the stomach.
It's a good rubber substitute. They wouldn't take my advice on that.
It would make very good bath mats.
What animal is it taken from? Unwillingly,
Doctor. Sheep,
I think.
Cow.
Steer,
cow.
Cattle, yes, cow. That's right. Now, how about sweetbreads? If you're eating sweetbreads, what are you eating, Mr. Levant?
A brain.
The pancreas.
That's just wishful thinking, Mr. Levant.
The pancreas.
The pancreas. What are pancreas, Mr. Adams?
Is it something in the throat?
Oh, no, it's a liver thing.
Well, I believe pancreas are sort of gland, aren't they?
Around the liver.
The pancreatic gland.
Well, there is a gland in them. They're little odd things of no particular interest to anybody.
But very good.
Doubtless very good. That come from a calf or of a similar animal. Now, about giblets?
Maybe with the meat shortage, we should be eating appendices.
Very possibly. Giblets, gentlemen. What are giblets? Mr. Hitchcock.
Giblets are the unused part of a chicken.
Well, they're not unused if you eat them.
From
they're
an used edible standpoint.
They're used in our house.
We make gravy from them.
Well, if you don't make gravy from them, but eat giblets just so.
It's anatomically
chicken liver.
Well, the liver, the gizzard.
That's right.
And
the
also the heart. All those things are giblets. And as a matter of fact, very good, too. How about this one from Grace Chiafalo of Brooklyn? This is a musical question, gentlemen. I want you to name the composer of these pieces of incidental music and the play that each adorns. Let's have the first. Got a hand at once from Mr. Levant.
Midsummer Night's Dream, Shakespeare.
Shakespeare.
Mendelssohn wrote the music.
Mendelssohn wrote the music for Midsummer Night's Dream. That's quite right. Now, how about the next? Mr. Hitchcock? That was your hand, wasn't it?
Yeah, Mr. Levant.
Mr. Levant.
If Mr. Hitchcock knows it, I would...
Mr. Levant.
He's awfully nice, Mr. Hitchcock is.
Well, it's Lars Lien Suite by Bizet.
Yes.
That's quite right. La Légende, the Prelude by Bizet. That's quite right. Now the third and last. Mr. Levant again.
That's a September song by Kurt Weill and Maxwell Anderson.
Yes, what's the play called?
Something about Knickerbocker.
Holiday?
Well, that's it.
That's it. That's 3 out of 3, Mr. Levant, and good going. By the way, Mr. Hitchcock, weren't you going to say La Légende by Bizet on that second one?
I was, but I didn't know the play to which it was connected. That's why I hesitated.
Oh, that's too, you're too cautious. On this program, we're never cautious.
You asked for the play to be named.
Well, isn't there a play called La Légende?
Maybe I
wasn't. Mr. Levant, do you know?
Well,
or is it just
wasn't,
an opera?
He didn't get paid off, Bizet. He wrote incidental music for the play.
Yes. How about this, from Margaret B. Rawn of Lancaster, Pennsylvania. Again, on this one, get 2 out of 3. This is about famous cases, some of the murder cases. In which famous case was the guilt fixed by the purchase of hyoscine? The purchase of hyoscine. Mr. Hitchcock.
The Crippen case.
That's quite right. Will you tell us a little about that, Mr. Hitchcock?
Well, Dr. Crippen was an American dentist who lived in London. And he was married to a music hall performer, a woman called Belle Elmore. And he gave her hyoscine. He was in love with his secretary.
Hyoscine is a poison, of course.
Poison, yes. And then he eventually disposed of the remains of the body in his house in Islington, in London. And then escaped with his secretary to Canada. And the case was one where wireless was used for the first time to apprehend a criminal.
That's a perfect answer, Mr. Hitchcock.
And Dr. Crippen was arrested in the mouth of the St. Lawrence by an Inspector Dew, who came aboard disguised as a pilot officer.
How was the tide running at the time? That's first rate. Now, how about this? In what famous case was guilt fixed by a ticket to Syracuse? A ticket to Syracuse.
Will that be an American?
Yeah, I know.
That was. I have
the
several.
Snyder-Gray case.
That's
yeah.
Right, Mr. Adams. The Snyder-Gray case. Do you remember how that happened?
Snyder-Judge.
Mr. Fathom, I was going to guess it.
Mr. Gray
was on a corset-selling tour in Syracuse and went to the hotel there at the time.
Yes, so that was his
and
alibi.
He fled there after the ex post facto.
That's right. He tried to establish an alibi by having the tickets discovered in Syracuse, indicating that he'd gone to Syracuse at the time that he was supposed to have done the murder, I suppose. Now, how
I
about
went to Syracuse a couple months ago.
You were there?
Yeah.
Gloomy cuss, aren't you? Now, in what case was the guilt fixed by uniforms buried in sand? Uniforms buried in sand. The discovery of them established the guilt of people connected with them. Well, there's one you don't happen to know, apparently. The case of the Nazi saboteurs who were recently apprehended on Long Island and in the coast of Florida, too. They buried the uniforms along with money and explosives and firearms. And uniforms were discovered, and they, as you know, were apprehended and executed. Well, that gives us 2 out of 3. How about this one from F. Cook of Berkeley, California? Where in literature or the theater does the action concern a glove? The action revolves around a glove. It might be in a poem or play, Mr. Adams.
No, I'm wrong. I won't do it.
Mr. Kieran?
Well, in Browning's famous poem about the woman who threw the glove into the den of lions, in fact, 3 different poets wrote poems about that.
That's right, Mr. Kieran. Who were the 3 poets?
Browning was one. I believe Leigh Hunt was
right.
Another. And I've forgotten who
I think a German poet. Was it Schiller?
You forgot your glove.
I know there were 3, anyhow.
You forgot your glove. Da-da-da-da-da-da.
That makes 4. Oh. Yeah. That wasn't Schiller, that last one, though, Mr. Levant. I can tell that. Now, where does the action concern a garter? We move from gloves to garters. Mr. Kieran.
At the founding of the Order of the Knights of the Garter in the English court, I believe.
Yes, but that would be historical rather than in literature or the theater.
Anyway.
Mr. Adams.
In a play called Getting Gertie's Garter.
Yes. Who wrote the play, Mr. Adams?
I don't know, but I think Mr. A.H. Woods produced it.
And it was written by Avery Hopwood and Wilson Collison, Mr.
Levant. I don't connect any crime with that.
No, no. You want to get crime at every question?
That's the question before
I can.
No, there's no crime involved. This is a harmless, joyful, gay question. Mr. Levant?
There was a memorably funny sketch by Noel Coward called La Flamme with Beatrice Lilly and Noel Coward, in which you see her garter from time to time. Miss Lilly's garter.
I don't remember that, but doubtless you do.
Funny and other things.
Yes. Now we have a glove and a garter. Now, where does the action concern a girdle? This might be from mythology or the theater or poetry, Mr. Kieran.
Well, I think it was an attempt to get Minerva's girdle, wasn't there?
It wasn't Minerva, I don't think. Any of you remember a little more closely than Mr. Kieran does? Almost impossible. Have to count that wrong unless you give us the exact data. Well, it was one of the tasks of Hercules. One of the 12 tasks of Hercules was to...
I thought it was Minerva.
To get the girdle of Hippolyta.
Oh.
Hippolyta,
right.
The queen of the Amazons.
Then there was Ziegfeld, who wrote this thing glorifying the American girl.
Is that the play called Boy Meets Girdle? Is that the one?
The best tunes of all move to Carnegie Hall. Yes, the best tunes of all move to Carnegie Hall.
Ladies and gentlemen, make no mistake. In a cigarette, it's the tobacco that counts. And Lucky Strike means fine tobacco. So round, so firm, so fully packed, so free and easy on the draw. No wonder that with independent tobacco experts, with men who know tobacco best, it's Lucky's 2-to-1.
The best tunes of all move to Carnegie Hall. Yes, the best tunes of all move to Carnegie Hall.
And now, with everybody's permission, we'll get back to the program. This comes from Mrs. Irving Goldman of Brooklyn, New York. I would like you to recite for us three proverbs or quotations, well-known sayings, that mention different servants or household workers. Not by name, but by grade. Yes, Mr. Adams.
Well done, thou good and faithful. Servant.
Yes, that's right. That's a dandy. That covers the whole field. And now let's name a specific kind of worker. Mr. Kieran?
The steward wrote, the butler squalled, and so forth. It's in Tennyson's The Sleeping Beauty, Princess, describing the reawakening of the household.
That's an unfamiliar one, or at least unfamiliar to me. Mr. Levant?
Waiter, water, I don't know.
There was a funny song about it.
Yeah, waiter, water.
Waiter, water. Yeah, that's right, Mr. Adams.
Well, that's ration now.
Mr. Adams?
Where are you going, my pretty maid?
Maid, yes, very good. What a bright wit you have, Mr. Adams. Mr. Kieran?
They also serve who only stand and wait.
Yes, doesn't mention the waiter particularly. Mr. Adams again?
How green was my valley?
Well, this program will be over in a little while. Now here's one from Ensign Murray Harris of Washington, D.C. Here are some made-up headlines. What emperors, whether of the past or present, are involved in them? The first headline is, Duke gives emperor shellacking. Now, this refers to a real emperor, Mr. Kieran.
The Duke of Wellington on June 18th, 1815.
Yes.
Daylight saving.
The Battle of Waterloo with a little aid from Blücher.
Yes. Defeated?
Napoleon.
Yes. Defeated the Emperor Napoleon. Very good. Now, how about this headline? Empress switches boyfriends. Empress switches boyfriends.
Catherine.
Pardon?
Catherine, as played by Marlene Dietrich.
Yes, or played by anybody.
You can understand it in her.
Catherine the Great of what country?
It used to be Russia of her time.
Yes, Russia of her time. And she was given to changing boyfriends, often in midstream. Now, here's a third and last. Emperor slapped down, king again after 5 years. Emperor slapped down, king again after 5 years. That applies to whom?
Karl of Romania was out for 5 years.
I don't know that he was ever an emperor, though.
He was slapped down.
True enough. But he never was an emperor.
All right.
There are some people who think
Nine Days
was
a Queen. That doesn't fit.
No, it doesn't fit. Gentlemen, Victor Emmanuel was emperor of Ethiopia and Italy from 1936 to 1941. But when the British recaptured it, of course, he became king of Italy. Neither what I would call a durable job. Well, that gives us 2 out of 3 on that. And sends us on to a question from Donald Barr of New York City. In what movie about spies, all of these questions are about movies that involve spies, in what one is a spy plot overheard by a man who is trying to recover his lost golf clubs? A spy plot.
spy plot is overheard by a man who's trying to recover his lost golf clubs. Well, if you haven't seen the movie, you just won't know the answer.
What's the movie?
If I gave you the title, you could give me the name, doubtless.
Well, we give up. What is it?
Night Train. The one which Rex Harrison and Margaret Lockwood appeared. Remember that, Mr. Hitchcock?
I never saw it. I never go to movies.
You never go to movies? Well, there are some very good ones produced by a man named Hitchcock. If you want to go to see
every once
in a
while.
You don't go to those. Well, the rest of us make up for you. In what movie about spies does the butler show he recognizes his master by serving him a glass of milk? The butler serves a man a glass of milk, and by this gesture, he indicates that he knows who he is. Well, it's in a movie called Nazi Agent, in which Conrad Veidt appears.
Didn't see it.
Didn't see that? Say, that must be the only one you never saw, Oscar.
Well,
you must have had a cold.
That's too wrong. How about this one? In what movie is a spy ring discovered in a windmill? Spy ring discovered in a windmill.
Mr. Hitchcock's Foreign Correspondent.
Didn't you even see that one, Mr. Hitchcock?
A bit of it.
Yes, that's the only one we got right. And that sends a $50 war bond to Mr. Barr, courtesy of Lucky Strike, and a set of the Encyclopedia Britannica to boot. And sends us on to a question from Laverne Verplank of Rochester, New York. Who exposed whom in the following situations? A villain was exposed by his own wife. Mr. Kieran.
Well, I think in part, Iago was exposed by his wife.
Yes. Yes, he was. What was his wife's name, Kieran?
His wife's name, I can't think of it all.
Adams generally remembers the lady's name. Mr. Adams, do you remember?
I don't remember. Mrs. I used to call her.
Amelia. Probably Amelia W. Iago. Yes, she explains the handkerchief plot after Desdemona's death. Now, how about this one? An ex-clerk, risen to the rank of partner, is exposed by another clerk. Mr. Hitchcock?
I'm not certain. I was wondering whether it was Goldsworthy's Justice.
I don't think so, but I'm not certain, and you may be quite right.
That situation did occur.
That's what I'd have said.
Well, that settles. It probably is right. Mr. Kieran, another answer?
I think that's in David Copperfield.
Yes,
who was
the one?
Uriah Heep, who was exposed, of course, by the ebullient Mr. Micawber.
That's right. Yes, that was the one that I remembered because that's the book I happen to have read, Mr. Hitchcock. Now, how about this one? An enemy agent is exposed by a fellow worker in an airplane factory. Mr. Levant.
Mr. Hitchcock's saboteur.
Mr. Hitchcock's saboteur, yes. Mr. Hitchcock, either you have no memory at all or you are unduly modest.
I'm afraid it's the latter.
Oh. Well, I would have thought so if you had answered differently. How about this one from Dean S. Smith of Minneapolis? Gentlemen, I want you to create for us, right on this platform here, a meal of at least three courses, each of which includes a wine or liquor in the cooking or preparation. Now, let's begin with a course that generally does begin a meal. How about it, Mr. Hitchcock?
Do you say which includes a wine or
in the cooking or preparation of the food?
Bœuf à la mode.
Bœuf à la mode would give us the main course. What wine would be used in bœuf à la mode?
I would say a Burgundy or any leftovers.
Yes,
are used in the kitchen.
As long as it's a red wine.
Yes, a red wine.
That's quite right. Well, that gives us our entree. But usually, before an entree, we have what?
You can have grapefruit with anything you want in it.
Soup.
Say, that's right. You can. You Mr. Can Adams.
You could
have a soup with sherry.
I was going to say.
What soup though?
Very often mock turtle.
Yeah, turtle soup,
no,
sherry. Mr. Kitka?
Not mock turtle.
Not mock turtle.
Regular turtle.
Real turtle.
He has never had real turtle, Mr. Hitchcock. He only knows mock turtle. Yes.
Borscht. You don't put any wine in borscht.
No. There is no way of improving borscht. That gives us soup or entree. Now, we ought to get something to end our meal with, Mr. Hitchcock.
Oh, you can have cherries jubilee.
How is that made?
Liqueurs.
Yes.
In which you cook the cherries and pour the whole thing over some
pour over your face.
Ice cream.
Yum, yum.
You're making Mr. Adams faint.
You have crepe Suzette.
How do you make that?
You make this a small pancake cooked in liqueurs.
Quite a match any place you can make
it. Mr. Kieran?
You can have old-fashioned plum pudding with the brandy burning on it.
Yes, and to judge from that equatorial waistline of Mr. Hitchcock, he has all of them. Well, that gives us three out of three, and now here's Mr. Rysdale and Mr. Cross.
The best tunes of all move to Carnegie Hall. Yes, the best tunes of all move to Carnegie Hall.
Ladies and gentlemen, the story of what makes a better cigarette
can be told in just two words: fine tobacco. For in a cigarette, it's the tobacco that counts. And smokers, Lucky Strike means fine tobacco. At auctions all over the South, year after year, we consistently select and buy the riper, lighter, milder Lucky Strike leaf. No wonder that with independent experts, with men who know tobacco best, it's Lucky's 2-to-1. In choosing your own cigarette, take a tip from the experts. Remember, Lucky Strike means fine tobacco. So round, so firm, so fully packed, so free and easy on the draw.
The best tunes of all move to Carnegie Hall. Yes, the best tunes of all move to Carnegie Hall.
Thank you, Mr. Rysdale and Mr. Cross. And now a question from Leon Chase of Providence, Rhode Island. If a commanding officer were ordered to attack enemy positions with these forces, I'll name them for you, would he be operating with numerically superior or inferior forces? Now, suppose he were in command of a platoon against a section. Would he be superior or inferior to the enemy? He had a platoon, the enemy had a section. Mr. Kieran.
He would be inferior to the enemy.
No, as I understand it, he would be superior.
Well, I don't know what in the world a section is, but a platoon is pretty small, I can tell you that.
Yes, but a section is apparently smaller still. It comes between a squad and a platoon.
Yeah. It's a new invention.
Well, I wouldn't have known it either if I hadn't had it on this card. He would be superior. Now, suppose he were in command of a battalion and were operating against a brigade. Mr. Hitchcock.
He'd be inferior.
He would be inferior. That's quite right. Numerically inferior. And suppose he were in command of a field army operating against an army corps. Mr. Hitchcock again.
Oh, I would say he's still inferior.
No, he would be superior in that case. How did you know, Mr. Adams?
I could have guessed the same way.
Well, the corps is smaller than the field army.
Because a corps is smaller than a field army. That's quite right. Field army is the largest unit, as I understand it. Well, that gives us two wrong, and sends a $50 war bond to Mr. Chase, plus a set of the Britannica, courtesy of Lucky Strike, and sends us on to this question from Miss Casey Adams of Montreal, Canada. This is a poetical question, gentlemen. I'm going to ask you simply to complete these quotations. Between the cradle and the grave, how can you complete the quotation?
I mean, there is a real... Between the cup and the lip.
No. Actually, the completion of the quotation gives you a rhyme. Mr. Adams? I should expect that was one of your favorite poets.
Do it again, Mr. Price.
Between the cradle and the grave lies a haircut and a shave. From Sam Hoffenstein's Songs of Faith in the Year After Next. That gives us one wrong. Now, how about completing this one? And so betwixt them both, you see, Mr. Adams.
They licked the platter clean.
Yes, how does that begin?
Mr. and Mrs. Spratt.
Yes, and what is the whole story, Mr.
Jack
and Mrs. Spratt
could eat no fat, his wife could eat no lean, and then your part.
They'd have a tough time these days. Now, here's another one to complete. Between the dark and the daylight. Mr. Kieran.
When the night is beginning to lower, comes a pause.
Lower.
All right, lower. Comes a pause in the day's occupation, which is known as the children's hour.
Yes. Got you there, Mr. Adams. So it is a lower instead of lower. Mr. Adams is quite right. What does it mean? What does lower mean, Mr. Adams?
Lower.
No.
You're lucky if it's threatened.
Something like that, yes. Well, I guess that's all we'll have time for. Thank you, Mr. Hitchcock, for adding to the entertainment this evening. Now, in a few seconds, I'll announce next week's guests. Tonight, Lucky Strike has paid out two sets of the Encyclopedia Britannica and two $50 war bonds. And speaking of bonds, here's one way to think about them. Suppose you knew that you could shorten the war by just 1 second. Suppose that second to have been the time it took for one of the Nazi child murderers to kill your own son or brother or father. Suppose you could abolish that fatal second by the purchase of a bond. You'd buy, wouldn't you? Well, your bond purchases do shorten the war. Each bond you buy makes it possible to destroy more Nazi child murderers. Each Nazi child murderer that you kill with your bond means that the chances are increased for your own American boy to come back to you safe and sound. You tell me a better reason for buying war bonds. Next week, in addition to Mr. Adams and Mr. Kieran, we will have as our guests the co-authors of that charming bestseller, Our Hearts Were Young and Gay, Cornelia Otis Skinner and Emily Kimbrough.
Remember to send letters with questions and the correct answers to Information, Please, at 480 Lexington Avenue, New York City. And now a parting message from Mr. L.A. Speed Riggs, famous tobacco auctioneer from Goldsboro, North Carolina.
Support for Community Radio on WSKB is provided by Betts Plumbing and Heating Supply Company, an independent, family-owned wholesaler serving Westfield for over 50 years, specializing in plumbing, heating, and industrial piping supplies. On the web at BettsPlumbing.com or at 14 Coleman Avenue in Westfield.
Hi, it's Bob Plass, and I have Wow, It's Tuesday, every Tuesday, 6 to 8. Wow, It's Tuesday.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
I did it!
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 at 89.5 FM, WSKB Westfield.
And this is J. Pagluka with JP's Golden Age of Radio. Just ahead, we've got an Alfred Hitchcock episode. What's the, this was from the Lux Community Theater or
Lux
something?
Radio Theater, Lux, yeah, Lux the Radio. 39 Steps.
Ah, so you'll be able to hear an actual radio play of one of Alfred Hitchcock's stories. They're always fun, always keeps you on the edge of your seat. Before we go there, though, you know, we talked before we went to that last episode, we were talking about all of the entertainment that goes on here around Greater Westfield. And, of course, WestfieldLiveMusic.com is where you can go to find out a lot about some upcoming shows. They should be great. Check that out. Of course, check out Brewfest on the 28th of this month. That's a benefit for the Westfield Children's Museum.
Buy your tickets early because we're going to keep that kind of limited.
So. Where can you get those tickets?
The Amelia Park Children's Museum website. There's a section for Brewfest on there.
Excellent. All right, go there. And another thing is, and I'd forgotten to mention this before, tomorrow evening, I'm going to be out at the Lake George Tavern in Wales, Massachusetts. Now, it's like out in the middle of nowhere in the where you
I did a graduation party there.
Yeah, did you really?
Yep.
It's a cool little place. It's just south of Brimfield. So if you look it up, the Lake George Tavern, just south of Brimfield in Wales, Mass., I'm going to be there working with a band called Deep Cover. And these guys are great. If you like Genesis, Emerson, Lake, and Palmer, yes. Great classic music. These guys do it very, very well, and I'm looking forward to working with them. I'm doing sound for them out there, so come on out and say hello from 5 until 9 Saturday evening. Tonight you mentioned there were a couple other things going on around here, Peter.
Our friends from C.A. Jones are playing over at the Trinity Pub at the Irish Cultural Center.
And?
Full band.
Yeah.
And Trailer Trash is part of the MGM Summer Concert Series.
Oh, and these are all are all free concerts.
Yeah, they're both free. I mean, I would if I was going to the Trinity Pub, I would book a table. They have the indoor and outdoor patio. They have the indoor restaurant and the pub, and they have the outdoor patio. I would assume that C.A. Jones is playing outside. The weather looks to be pretty good tonight.
And I believe
Trailer Trash is out on the plaza.
Yeah, outside there in front of that.
So go to Wahlburgers, have your burger, and then walk over.
and
or Red Rose.
The 60s Experience, and the drummer for the 60s Experience works with Charlie Galvin. So if you want to come out and see some great 60s music, that's happening tonight out at Shaker Farms. So lots of great music everywhere.
Go to Facebook. Favorite your favorite joints, and they will send you notifications when your favorite band. Like I favorited Sonny's Place, and I get a whole bunch of notifications. Fort Hill Brewery has a lot of great stuff. Skyline Brewery has a lot of great musical acts. So there's a ton of stuff. Just favorite your favorite stuff on Facebook. I mean, there's a really good blues band coming to the Brass Horse down in New Hartford, Connecticut. They've had some great bands down there.
I don't think I've ever been in there.
It's
I know
right
where
on Route
New
44.
Hartford is. Yeah.
Right on Route 4. They just had a big building downtown burned down over the this
Ooh,
week.
I didn't know that. No,
yeah,
I,
right downtown.
Yeah, and that's not that far from here. If you go down the down through Granby and it's about
half an hour.
Yeah, it's a nice winding road and a nice drive out to there. So anyway, that's all the stuff that's happening. So let's jump into a break and then
we can go right into it.
into Alfred Hitchcock.
From Hollywood, California, the Lux Radio Theater presents Robert Montgomery and Ida Lupino in The 39 Steps. Lux presents Hollywood. For your loyalty to our products, Lux says thank you, ladies and gentlemen, and brings you another hour of entertainment direct from the film capital. Tonight, we star Robert Montgomery, Ida Lupino, Isabel Jewell, and Gene Lockhart, with Major C.E. Russell, formerly of the United States Intelligence Service, as the evening's special guest. Louis Silvers conducts the orchestra. And here beside me, our producer and your host, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Cecil B. DeMille. Greetings from Hollywood, ladies and gentlemen. The 39 Steps lead an old friend and a newcomer, Robert Montgomery and Ida Lupino, to the stage of the Lux Radio Theater. Since here last, Robert Montgomery's been rushing back and forth between two lots. One is the Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer studio, where with Rosalind Russell, he's completed Live, Love, and Learn. The other is a lot in Beverly Hills, on which Bob has just finished building a new home with a beautiful library. And Bob is a man who really uses his library, for he's constantly seeking new screen material. President of the Screen Actors Guild, Bob devotes at least three nights a week to that organization. So this fall, he took time off to go to his farm in New York State for a few weeks of partridge and pheasant hunting. His favorite Hollywood sport is tennis, in which activity he's expert enough to be the frequent opponent of Sidney Wood, the ex-Davis Cup player. Bob is heard tonight as Richard Hannay in The 39 Steps, adapted from the Gaumont British film, which in turn was taken from the novel by John Buchan. Gaumont British will shortly release The Girl Was Young, starring Nova Pilbeam and Derek DeMarne, directed by Alfred Hitchcock. Ida Lupino is a girl I've watched very closely and suggest that you do the same, for every Lupino seems destined for greatness in the theater. To American film audiences, she's the best-known representative of perhaps the oldest stage family in the world. 350 years ago, when acting was considered a crime in Italy, Alfredo Lupino, acrobat and troubadour, fled from Naples, turned gypsy, and eventually found welcome and fame in England. Ever since then, Lupinos have added to the excellence of England's entertainment. Ida's father is Stanley Lupino, among London's most popular comedians. She has a sister, two cousins, three uncles, and five aunts, all noted performers. While her mother is Connie Emerald, once a celebrated dancer. Along with 3.5 centuries of tradition, Ida has inherited a turned-up nose, violet eyes, and blonde hair. She's an excellent musician and painter, can speak the language of the deaf and dumb, whistles as well as a farm boy, likes to wear sneakers, and is a prize mimic. A highly entertaining miss, you meet her tonight in the role of Pamela. Isabel Jewell, featured in such hit films as Lost Horizon and Marked Woman, is heard as Annabella. And Gene Lockhart, top-flight character actor, back from the New York stage, is Mr. Memory. And now for the play. The Lux Radio Theater presents Robert Montgomery and Ida Lupino in The 39 Steps with Isabel Jewell and Gene Lockhart. A London music hall. The evening performance is on, and the theater is jammed to the doors. The audience has sat comfortably through the acrobats, the singers, and the whirlwind dancers. But now they're restless. The manager appears on the stage to announce the feature act. His hand is raised for silence.
Ladies and gentlemen, with your kind permission, I now have the honor to present to you one of the most remarkable men in the world. I present Mr. Memory.
Thank you. Thank you.
Every day this remarkable mentality commits 50 new facts to memory. 50, ladies and gentlemen. Facts from history, geography, newspapers, scientific books. Millions and millions of them. And he remembers them all. Test him, ladies and gentlemen. Test him. Ask him any questions you like. and he will answer fully and freely. Mr. Memory.
Thank you. Thank you. Now then, ladies and gentlemen, a question, please. A question from anyone in the audience.
Who won the Derby in 1921?
Mr. Jack Jewell's Humanist. Steve Donahue up, won by a length, odds 6-1. Am I right, sir? Thank you very much. Thank you. Question, please. Do not hesitate. Another question, please.
Who was the last British heavyweight champion?
Bob Fitzsimmons. He defeated Jim Corbett, heavyweight champion of America, at Carson City, Nevada, in October 1897. He was then 34 years of age. Am I right, sir? Thank you.
Mr. Memory, Mr. Memory, who won the football cup in 1926?
Would you mind repeating that question again, young man?
Who won the football cup in 1926?
Bolton Wanderers defeated Manchester City at Wembley by 3-1 in the presence of His Majesty the King. Am I right, sir?
Right there.
Thank you. Another question, please.
Hey, where's my old man been since last Tuesday?
Madam, he's been where you can't ask him silly questions. Will the lady in the gallery please confine her questions to those of a more serious nature? Thank you very much.
Memory! What's the idea? Who killed Cock Robin?
Gentlemen! Gentlemen, no fighting! No fighting, please, gentlemen! Keep your seats! Everybody keep your seats! Don't crowd the aisles! Orchestra, play something! Quick, you're panic, play something!
Stand back, please.
Oh, help me, please.
Hold on to my arm, miss. I'll get you out of this. Get back there. Clear the aisle there, will you? This way, miss. This way. Come on.
There you are, miss. Take a good deep breath.
Oh, thank you.
You all right?
Yes, sir. I had to get out of that theater, that's all.
A lot of people had that idea.
Oh, it wasn't the panic that frightened me. It was something else.
I'm afraid I don't understand.
I'm in terrible trouble. Will you help me?
Trouble? What kind of trouble?
I can't tell you here. Can we go someplace and talk?
Well, my flat is nearby.
Oh, let's go there. But hurry, please.
Go in, miss.
Thank you.
Now, if I can find this light switch.
Oh, no. Don't turn on the light.
What?
Don't turn them on. It will be safer.
I'm afraid I don't...
Will you pull down the blind, please?
Very well. This just puts me doubly in the dark. My name's Richard Hannay. Any objections to telling me yours?
No, it's Annabella Smith.
Smith? Not really.
Is there anything wrong with it?
No, just an unusual name. What's this all about? You said you were in trouble.
You don't believe me, do you?
I believe you're slightly hysterical.
If I am, I have good reason. I was the one who fired those shots in that theater tonight.
You? Why?
I had to do something to create a disturbance. I had to get away from there. There were two men in that theater who wanted to kill me.
Oh, come on.
Well, you've got to believe me.
But why should anyone want to kill you?
Because I'm what you would call a professional spy.
A spy? Whom do you spy for?
Anyone who pays me.
I suppose you're here to dig up some big state secret.
No. I'm here to save a secret. For England.
Oh. Go on, please.
The agent of a certain foreign power is on the point of obtaining a secret vital to your air defense. I tracked two of his men to that music hall. Unfortunately, they recognized me. That's why they're after me now. You still don't believe me, do you?
No, frankly, I don't, Annabella.
Very well. If you will look out of that window, you will see two men standing across the street. Look. Please do.
All right. I'll play your game a bit further.
Well, don't let them see you. Well?
By Jove, you're right. Two of them. They seem to be looking up here.
Come away, please. Do you believe me now?
Well, I suppose I must.
I'm going to tell you something that's not very healthy to know. But now that they've followed me here, you're in it as much as I am.
Yeah, so it seems.
Have you ever heard of the 39 steps?
39 steps? No, what are they?
Never mind, but this much you must know. If those men are not stopped, it's only a matter of days, perhaps hours, before the secret is out of the country.
Why not call the police?
Because they wouldn't believe me any more than you did. And if they did believe me, how long do you think it would take them to get going? Those men are acting quickly. You don't know how clever their chief is. Clever and ruthless.
Well, what's his name?
He has a dozen names, and he can look like 100 people. But there's one thing he can't disguise. The top of the little finger on his right hand is missing.
Oh. Come on now, you're trembling.
I'm frightened.
Well, you needn't be. You're safe here, you know. What you need is a good night's rest.
Oh, yes, I do.
You can have my bedroom. I'll sleep on the couch here in the living room.
Are you sure you don't mind?
Sleeping on the couch? Well, I've done it dozens of times.
No. I mean, being in danger.
I'm not quite convinced of that yet. Is there anything I can get you?
Yes. Have you a map of Scotland, please?
A map of Scotland? I have an atlas over here somewhere. If I could... Oh, yes, here it is. Going deer stalking or just plain hiking?
There's a man in Scotland I must see next if there is anything to be done.
I see. Are the 39 steps in Scotland?
Perhaps I'll tell you tomorrow. Good night, Mr. Henning. Thank you.
Good night, Annabella. Pleasant dreams. Annabella. Annabella, was that you? Annabella, open that door. Will you open that door, or do I have to break it down? Annabella, where are you?
Oh, I...
Here, look at me. What's happened? What's the matter?
They came through the window. One of them had a knife.
Knife?
Oh, don't touch me.
But you're hurt. You're bleeding. Here, I'll call a doctor.
Oh, no, it's no use. Listen, you've got to stop those men. In a few days, they'll have the secret out of the country.
But how will I stop them?
Kenrich. The professor.
Kenrich.
Scotland.
What's there? Who is this professor? What's in Kenrich?
They're up. They'll get you like they did me.
Annabella. Annabella. Good God. Ticket to Kenrich, please.
One, sir?
Yes, one. Hurry, please.
One to Kenrich, Scotland. Here you are, sir.
Excuse me, is this seat taken?
Not by us, it ain't. Sit down, young fella.
Thank you.
Oh, Sir Jess, who won the 2 o'clock at Epsom?
Here it is. Bachelor Button, odds 7-4.
Ah, Bachelor Button, eh?
Hello, look at this. Another woman murdered in a West End flat.
Murdered, eh? Who was she?
A well-dressed woman of about 25 was found with a knife in her back. The tenant, Richard Annay, is missing.
Why, if that ain't the blasted limit. Missing, eh?
The police are hot on the trail and watching with careful eye all points of departure from London.
Oh, so that was what they was a-doing, eh?
Who?
Scotland Yard. Two plainclothes bobbies. I seen them get on this train. Asking plenty of questions they was, too.
Look here. Here's a picture of that, eh, chap?
Let's have a squint at him. Rum-looking lot, ain't he?
Excuse me.
Here, young fellow, where are you going? Don't you like that seat?
Oh, thank you. I just remembered.
In a bit of a hurry, wasn't he?
He was, that. I say.
What?
I say.
away.
Oh, I beg your pardon. This is a private compartment.
Oh, is it?
Yes, and it happens to be occupied.
Yes, so I see. Very charmingly, too.
Well, what do you want, please?
Your hospitality for a short while.
Really? Well, I'm not interested. Now, will you please go?
I can't.
What?
It isn't safe.
Listen, are you going or shall I call the conductor?
No, don't do that.
Stop, you're hurting my wrist.
I'm sorry, Listen to me. I want your help.
My help?
I'm Richard Hannay.
Hannay? Why, you're the man the police...
Yes, but I'm innocent. I swear I'm innocent. Listen, you've got to help me. It's terribly important that I be free for the next few days. You will help me, won't you?
Yes. Yes, of course I will.
That's fine. I'm sorry if I hurt your wrist.
Oh, that's all right. You say the police are on this train looking for you?
Yes, that's why I forced my way in here.
Oh, I see. And just how am I supposed to help you?
Well, they're looking for a man traveling alone. If I stay here with you, they'll think we're together. We'll pose as man and wife, and they won't pay any attention to us. They'll just pass us by.
How clever you are.
You'll do it?
Yes, of course.
Say, you're all right. What's your name?
What's that got to do with it?
Nothing. I just wanted to know who my benefactress was, that's all.
No, I'm Pamela Stewart.
Pamela? Oh, that's rather pretty. Suits you.
Thank you.
There they are now. Remember, I'll sit here and pretend to read. You do the talking.
All right. Come in.
Excuse me. Have either of you seen a man pass here? Young fella, smooth shaven?
Why, no. Wait, are you the police?
That's right, miss.
Then this is the man you want. He forced his way in here and told me his name was Richard Hannay.
Why,
did I? Come here, you. Let go of me.
Are you Richard Hannay? Well, speak up.
Yes. Thank you very much, Miss Stewart.
Well, you didn't expect me to harbor a murderer, did you?
Unfortunately, I did. And I am not a murderer.
We'll see about that. Come on, Hannay.
Certainly, gentlemen. I'll go with you willingly. In fact, I'll lead the way.
Grab him. He's gone. Here, get after him. Open that door.
I can't. He's holding it from the other side.
Here, let me try. Together now. One, two, three. Get out of the way. Where is he? Where did he go?
Here he is, down the passageway.
Stop him. Grab him before he gets to the best of you.
Come back here, you. Come back, you. Stop, stop.
Have you got him?
No, he's gone.
What?
He jumped. He jumped off the train.
The fool. He's probably lying dead in a ditch.
No. The last I've seen of him, he was on his 2 feet and running like a rabbit.
During our first intermission and while waiting for Act Two of the 39 Steps starring Robert Montgomery and Ida Lupino, we'd like you to go with us to one of the millions of homes where Christmas secrets are in the air and listen in on a very interesting conversation.
Aunt Sally, come here. I want to see you alone.
More secrets, Betty? Well, the house is full of them.
Now the door's closed, we can talk. Aunt Sally, what can I give Mother for Christmas?
Did you ask her, dear?
Yes, and she just says all she wants from me is love and kisses.
Well, I did hear her say she needed more stockings. How about getting her some of the lovely sheer ones we saw in the store today?
But she always says sheer stockings are extravagant.
Not necessarily, dear. They wear very well if you're careful about washing. Just dip them in Lux suds every day. Lux keeps the silk nice and springy, so it doesn't break so easily into runs.
Then I'll tell you what. I'll buy some and tell Mother I'll Lux them for her, every time she wears them. I'll buy a big box of Lux and give it to her with the stockings.
Now that's a real Christmas gift, Betty.
Okay, I'll get some Lux Flakes right away.
And be sure to use nothing but Lux Flakes, dear. You know, rubbing stockings with a cake of soap is bad for them. And some soaps are strong, too harsh for delicate silk things.
Oh, thank you, Aunt Sally. You're an angel to help me. Mother's the most perplexing person on my list.
Stockings for Christmas and Lux Flakes for stockings. A perfect combination. We return now to Mr. DeMille and our play. Robert Montgomery, Ida Lupino, Isabel Jewell, and Gene Lockhart continue with the 39 Steps. Two days have passed, and Richard Hannay, wanted for a murder he did not commit, is still at large. Determined to discover the secret of the 39 Steps, he's made his way to Scotland. The driver of a donkey cart has given him a lift, and he's now on the last leg of the journey. the outskirts of the village of Kinreach.
Are you going to stay long in Kinreach, laddie?
Well, it all depends. I'm looking for work. You suppose I could find something?
Hey, me doots, laddie. Kinreach is a mighty small town. What do you do?
I'm a chauffeur.
Well, I'm thinking you'd better try somewhere else, then. What folks has need chauffeurs, and Kinreach has had them for years.
Oh, I see. But aren't there any newcomers? I mean, somebody told me about...
Now, wait a minute. I come to think of it, I did hear something. About a retired professor moving into the big house on the edge of the moor.
A professor? Yes. Yes, that's it. I can try it anyhow.
Yes, sir?
I'd like to see the master, please.
What name shall I say?
Well, he doesn't know my name, but you might ask him if he knows Annabella Smith.
Yes, sir. Will you mind waiting in
there? Is there someone for me, George?
Oh, yes, Professor.
How do you do?
How do you do? My name is Hammond. I've come from London. From Annabella Smith.
Oh. Well, do come in, please. You must be tired. We can talk in the library. My daughter's having an engagement party. I'd rather not disturb her.
Yes, of course.
Go right in, please.
Thank you.
Sit down. Will you have a drink?
No, thank you.
Well, now what did you want to see me about, Mr. Hannay?
Hannay, you know me.
Yes. I suppose it's safe to call you by your right name now. What about our mutual friend, Annabella?
She's been murdered.
I know. Poor girl. The police are looking for you.
Yes, but I didn't do it.
Oh, of course you didn't. But why come all this way to Scotland to tell me about it?
Well, I believe she hoped to come to see you about some air ministry secret. She was killed by a foreign agent who was trying to steal it.
Oh. Did she tell you what this foreign agent looked like?
No, she hadn't time. She... Oh. Oh, yes. There was one thing. She told me the top of his little finger is missing.
On which hand, Mr. Hannay?
On the left, I believe.
Are you sure it wasn't on the right?
It might have been.
Like on my hand, Mr. Hannay?
Good Lord. Then you're the one she...
The one she was trying to warn you against. The chief. You misunderstood her. She meant for you to kill me, not to bring me information.
Yes. Well, what are we going to do about it?
Ah, that's just the point. What are we going to do? You see, I live here as a respectable citizen. I should hate to have it known that I am not what I seem to be. You understand my position.
Oh, yes, quite.
What makes it doubly important that I shouldn't let you go is that I'm just about to transfer some very vital information out of the country.
What?
Oh, yes. I've got it already. I'm afraid poor Annabella would have been too late in any case.
Well... That's that, I suppose.
Yes. Well, what about it, Mr. Hannay?
What about what?
Yourself. It seems to me there's only one way out.
And what's that?
I've a small revolver here. Pretty little thing, isn't it? Supposing I left you alone with this. The newspapers could then announce tomorrow morning that the murderer had taken his own life.
You want me to kill myself?
Yes.
You're mad. I won't do it.
Then I'm afraid you leave me no alternative. You should have stayed in London, my friend. Oh, George. George.
Yes, Professor?
I want your help, please. There's a little job for us inside.
Annie?
Yes. We'll carry him to the garage. When it gets dark, we can drop him off on the road somewhere.
Yes, sir.
Come in.
Where is he, sir?
Behind that table.
Yes, sir?
Yes. Pick him up and...
I'm sorry, sir, but there's no one here.
What?
Well, you can see for yourself.
But I shot him. The body was lying there on the floor.
The body, sir? Seems to have disappeared.
By
by standing in front of my car. You might have been killed.
Sorry, lady. I just wanted a lift. Would you mind... Well, Miss Stewart, how do you do?
You? Well, what are you doing
Richard
here?
Richard Hannay is my name. I believe we've met. On a train, wasn't it?
Yes, I think so.
Yes. If I remember correctly, you handed me over to the police. You did, didn't you?
Oh, get away from me.
No, don't worry. I don't hold it against you, really.
Well, that's very kind of you.
Yes, isn't it? What are you doing in Kinreach?
I live here.
It's a charming place, isn't it? You know where the local police station is?
Oh, of course I do.
Will you take me there?
What?
The police station, in a hurry, please.
Certainly. Well, I suppose you know what you're doing.
Oh, yes. You see, I know who killed Annabella Smith.
Is that so?
The same man who shot me a few minutes ago.
Shot you?
Yes.
Where?
Right in the cigarette case. See? There's a hole in one side of it. Handy little thing, cigarette cases. If I hadn't been carrying it about in my vest pocket, the hole would have been in my chest.
Mm, and who was this arch villain?
Gentleman called the professor.
Professor? Oh, now, you don't mean Professor Bartley.
I didn't stop to inquire his last name.
Oh, come now,
it isn't as funny as that.
Do you actually mean you're going to the police with this story? That Professor Bartlett shot you? That he's the one who killed Annabella Smith?
Of course, why not?
Oh, and you expect them to believe it, I suppose.
Well, you don't, evidently.
No, and neither will they. Professor Bartlett, a murderer. Why, he's one of the best-liked men in the village and a very good friend of the sheriff's. I'm sure the sheriff will be interested in your story, Mr. Hannay.
Yes, I see your point. Hadn't occurred to me that... Stop the car, please. I'm getting out.
Oh, no, you're not.
Stop this car.
You said you wanted to go to the police. Well, that's just where you're going. And if you touch me or make a move to jump, I'll turn this car into a ditch.
Well, aren't you the sweet little thing?
Now, you just sit tight, Mr. Hannay, and don't make any sudden gestures. We're going rather fast.
You haven't the nerve, of course.
Haven't I? Just try me.
All right, I will.
Don't touch that brake.
Hang on. Where are you? Are you all right?
Quite all right, thank you.
You little fool, we might have been killed.
Hello there!
There's someone coming. Keep down.
Let go of me. Hello!
Shut up!
Over here, Richard Hannay!
Why, you...
Richard!
Grab that man!
All right, Hannay, we've got you. And don't try any funny business. Stand up.
Yes, of course.
Are you the police?
We've been looking for you, Hannay. Put the bracelets on him, Joe.
Right you are. Put out your hand. There we are.
Now put out the other one on the girl.
Here, what are you doing?
We are handcuffing you to your friend here. Any objections?
Now see what you've done.
Oh, shut up. Listen, you can't do this. I don't even know this man.
You ride around the country with him in a car, but you don't know him. Of course you don't.
Yes, but I'm telling you,
Keep your mouth shut. All right, Joe. Take him to our car. It's a good day's work for us.
Will you please move over?
You talking to me?
Yes, I am.
Very well.
Ow, my wrist.
Well, you asked me to move, and if I move, you move with me. It's a scientific fact that when two people are handcuffed together...
Officer, must I be chained to this man?
Aye, you must. And keep quiet about it.
Wait a moment. Where are you taking us? This isn't the way to the sheriff's office.
We're not exactly going to the sheriff's office. Eh, Joe?
Not exactly, no.
Well, where are we going?
Well, it's the real head we are going to see. The sheriff principal. Angel.
Aye, the sheriff principal.
I don't understand.
Would you like to have a small bet with me, Pamela Stewart?
Now, what do you mean?
I'll bet you 100-1 that the man they call the sheriff principal has the top joint of his little finger missing. Am I right, gentlemen?
You shut your mouth, young fellow, or I'll shut it for you. For good.
You see, Pamela, I win. They're taking us to your old friend, the professor. Charming gentleman, the professor. Best-liked man in the village and a personal friend.
Oh, be quiet, will you?
What are we stopping for?
Sheep. A whole flock of them across the road.
Well, blow your horn. Maybe that'll scare them.
Stubborn beast. They won't move an inch.
Well, come on. We'll have to get out and shoo them off.
Here, get on there, shoo. Get on there.
Go on. Get you to the way. Go on.
Now's our chance. We'll make a run for it.
Run? How can we?
Come on, when I say jump, jump and run for your life.
Yes, but they'll catch us.
Go on, jump.
Hey, look, they're getting away.
Stand where you are.
And there they go.
Give it to him.
They're shooting them.
Come on, you little fool, run for it.
Please, don't go so fast. You're hurting my wrist.
Shut up.
Oh. I can't go any further. I've lost my shoe.
Where?
Oh, back there.
Well, forget it. All right. Sit down. Sit down for a while.
You think we've lost those men?
No, it's as black as pitch on this moor. They'll never find us now.
You know, this is all very silly. You can't escape. What chance have you got handcuffed to me?
Keep that question for your husband when you get one. Meanwhile, I'll admit that you're the white man's burden.
Oh, yes, I know, and I can't tell you how it comforts me. Oh, why don't you give yourself up?
To whom?
Oh, give yourself up to Scotland Yard.
Thank you, but it's a little impractical at the moment. Listen to me. I told you the truth on the train, and I'm telling it to you now. There's a dangerous conspiracy against this country, and I'm the only man who can stop it.
Ha-ha, I don't believe you.
All right, very well, then. I'm just a plain, common murderer who stabbed an innocent, defenseless woman in the back in Portland Place, London. I don't know how innocent you may be, but you're a woman, you're defenseless, and you're alone on a desolate moor in the dark. And you're manacled to a murderer who would stop at nothing to get you off his hands. If that's the story you prefer, have it, my lovely, and welcome.
Well, I'm not afraid of you.
Why not? For all you know, I murdered a woman. You listen to a bit of advice. From now on, you do everything I tell you to do and do it quickly.
No, you wretched boy.
I admire your pluck, but you keep a civil tongue in your head. Otherwise, I might feel the next killing was a bit overdue. All right, on your feet now.
Well, where are we going?
I see some lights over that way. We'll do a little investigating.
Well, I won't go. I'm going to stay right here.
Pamela, are you forgetting I murdered a woman? Well?
Don't you strike me. I'll go. What kind of a place do you think this is?
I don't know. Looks like an inn. Now remember what I said. A civil tongue or else. And you back me up in everything I say or do. Do you understand?
Yeah.
Stay close to me and hold my hand. It'll hide the handcuffs. Good evening.
Good evening. Welcome to King's Head Tavern. And what can I do for you and the lady?
We had an accident with our car a few miles back.
Hey, that's too bad now. You want to stay the night, I suppose?
Yes, we do.
And will it be two separate rooms or one?
Oh, two separate
rooms.
One room, please.
One.
Well, which?
One, thank you.
Oh, one. And what's the name?
Hawkinson. Hawkinson, yes. Henry Hawkinson and Mrs. Hawkinson.
Well, come along, Mr. Hawkinson. The rooms are at the top of the landing.
Thank you. Nice place you have here.
It'll do. Here's the room.
Oh, thank you.
Well, good night to you.
Oh, wait. Now, wait, please. You mustn't go.
What's the matter, lass? Is there anything wrong?
Yes,
of course
well,
there's nothing wrong. She wants to tell you something, that's all.
Yes,
yes
I wanted
yes,
to...
Yes, you see, we're a runaway couple.
Ah, you know.
Yes. As a matter of fact, we've been running all night. If anyone inquires for us, you won't give us up, will you?
That I won't. I was young myself once. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Inside, Pamela.
Of all the outrageous things. Listen, you don't think I'm going to spend the night in this room with you?
Personally, I don't see how you can help yourself.
Stop jerking my arm.
I'm so sorry. I want to take my shoes off. My feet are tired. You better stand here by the fire and get warm. You'll be catching cold.
And if I did?
Stand by the fire.
Don't yell at me like that. I didn't ask to come with you.
And I didn't invite you. But here we are.
Well, aren't you afraid the men will find us?
I'm not thinking of that so much as some way to get out of these handcuffs.
Oh, I have a nail file in my pocket. Maybe that'll help.
That would be dandy. If you file 24 hours a day, 10 years from now, we might be free. Imagine, tied to you for 10 years. It's a horrible thought.
I've had enough of your insults. I'm going to tell the innkeeper the whole story.
You want me to hang for a murder I didn't commit?
As long as you hang, I don't care whether you committed it or not.
What a bloodthirsty creature you are. Haven't you any pity?
No.
Ow! What are you up to now?
I'm merely trying to file the handcuffs.
Well, don't jab me in the wrist that way. I don't like it.
I'm sorry.
You're going about it in a very amateurish fashion anyway. I can see you know nothing about filing handcuffs.
I'm sure you do. Tell me, how did you start being a criminal?
So you want the story of my life. It's really very interesting.
Oh, I'm sure it is.
I was born a poor orphan boy. From the beginning, I hadn't a chance. Ouch!
I'm sorry it slipped.
Accidentally?
Accidentally. Go on, please.
I started by pilfering pennies out of other children's lockers at school. And then a little pocket picking and car pinching. And at last my efforts were rewarded and I graduated into straight burglary.
With diploma?
With diploma.
Oh.
I killed my first man when I was 19. It scared me at first, but I soon got hardened to it. Lady, you wouldn't believe me if I told you.
It was your fault. The whole thing was your fault.
My fault? How do you make that out?
If you hadn't have stopped the car for those blasted sheep, we'd have had the two of them in the professor's parlor right now.
We'd better have them there soon is what I say. The professor was anxious about Hannay. Knows too much, he said. Get him.
Get him? We had him. And the girl, too.
You didn't suppose they'd head in somewhere, do you? Stop at a tavern, I mean.
They might, in this weather.
There's a place about 4 miles back. King's Head Tavern, it's called.
King's Head Tavern. That'd be somewhere near where they gave us the slip. Turn around. You'll find out.
Right.
And if we see him again, blast you. Shoot straight.
I will, all right. You can depend upon that.
And then little by little, and year by year, I sunk lower and lower.
And you got better and better.
That's right. You might have read about me in the papers. They called me Hannay, the Cornish Bluebeard. And that, milady, is the horrible story of my life.
Dear, dear, and you have such a nice face. How many people have you killed altogether?
Nine. If you don't watch the point on that nail file, it may be 10. Ouch!
At least I'm trying to do something.
Well, if you don't mind, I'm going to try and get some sleep. I haven't had a wink for 48 hours.
Well, I'm not in the least bit tired. Besides, I have to stay by the fire and get dry.
All right. You don't mind if I stretch out in the chair, do you?
No, not at all.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night. I don't see how you can sleep at a time like this. I said I don't see how you can sleep at a time like this.
I'm hardened to it. That's all. Hardened criminals sleep any time.
Listen. Listen, did you hear that? There's a car out there. It just drove up. A car.
It's your imagination.
It's not my imagination. I heard a car. Oh, all right, if you don't care.
Don't care. Just don't care.
Don't do that. What's the matter with you anyway?
Oh, I'm so sorry. You mustn't get frightened, Pamela. I have awful nightmares. I guess it's my conscience bothering me. Good night.
We pause for station identification. This is the Columbia Broadcasting System. We pause now between the scenes of the 39 Steps. Robert Montgomery and Ida Lupino will be back shortly when we raise the curtain on Act 3 in this play about spies. Spies may be roughly divided into two classes. There are the mercenary spies who traffic in state secrets, selling them for cash to the highest bidder. And there are patriots who risk their lives solely for the protection of their country, who receive the smallest monetary rewards, and whose names never get into the newspapers. The Richard Hannay of our play belongs to this second group, and so does tonight's guest, Major C.E. Russell of the United States Army, retired. Before this country entered the World War, Major Russell temporarily loaned his services to Scotland Yard as one of their American operatives. Back in the United States Army during the war, he served on a special staff in France. He later instructed our Army officers in the art of espionage and is the author of a standard military textbook on this subject. With such a background, Major, there should be no better authority to answer the question, just what are the qualifications that make a valuable spy?
The qualifications today, Mr. DeMille, are exactly the same as in biblical times, and the instructions which are taught follow very closely those which Moses gave to his men when he sent them forth to spy out the land of Canaan, to learn what the land contained, the strength of the enemy, if the people were content, and how strong were the walls. Then, as today, spies had to have powers of observation, of memory, and description. These are the three traits that must be developed in a capable espionage agent, and are the least developed of all human traits. In addition, he must have common sense, a good general education, an ability to take orders, and preferably, a knowledge of foreign languages.
I've noticed that the opinion held of a spy varies greatly. Some people have only the greatest respect and admiration for a spy. Others consider them vicious, double-dealing scoundrels who stop at nothing to attain their end.
How well do I know that? But I think these people would change their minds if they only realized that spies are one of the greatest forces for world peace. I am, of course, referring to patriotic spies, not mercenaries. I believe that a patriotic spy, by keeping his country informed of military activity in other lands, enables his own nation to properly prepare itself, and a properly prepared nation is a nation seldom attacked. The war that they are ready for rarely comes.
If what I've observed is true, you soldiers who fight with your brains instead of bayonets are finding more and more women as your co-workers. How does a woman compare with a man as a spy?
Very favorably, up to one point. A woman's heart will rule her head much more quickly than a man's. Today, there is probably one woman to every two men in the world's espionage service. We've learned that if you want to make a man talk, send a pretty woman. And when we want to make a woman talk, we make her jealous. Both theories work amazingly well.
It would appear to me that spying is one activity which provides little or no room for modernization. Along with qualifications, I presume that methods have changed little since the days of Moses.
That's very true, Mr. DeMille. They remain essentially unchanged, but there have been radical technical changes in carrying out those essentials. For instance, there's a machine recently developed in this country, so delicate and so accurate that it can etch an invisible secret message on a surface no larger than a grain of corn. Or, to employ a commodity with which perhaps you're more familiar, it could etch the map of an entire country on a single lux flake. And that's probably the finest, thinnest, and most fragile thing I can think of for the moment.
I know that you can read through a flake of lux, Major. It's actually only 2/1000th of an inch thick.
I see. Almost as amazing as this machine I'm speaking of. Lux flakes remind me of women. And women, in turn, recall an amazing spy story I encountered during the World War. It concerns a Swiss opera singer who volunteered in the French Red Cross as an entertainer. For 2 years, she made periodic visits to a home in Switzerland, each time using the same route over the French border. One day, she started to cross and found a new officer in charge. He took a good look at her and immediately ordered his women assistants to search her. They returned with the petticoat of this famous singer. Suspecting that it might contain invisible writing, the lieutenant called for hot irons and himself applied them to the petticoat. The heat revealed what had been invisibly written in lemon juice, the complete working drawings of a new French war tank. The reason the lieutenant had suspected Madame was that before the war, he had been a style designer in Paris. One of the first things he observed about the singer was that while she was dressed in the height of fashion, she wore a starched petticoat, and starched petticoats had been out of style for 10 years.
And to me, one of the truest utterances of the great French general, Marshal Foch, was his statement to a group of his espionage agents. "You will die 1,000 deaths," he told them, "before oblivion comes, while the man in the trenches dies but once."
And no better example can be found, Mr. DeMille, than that patriot of Revolutionary War, John Honeyman. Too old to carry arms, he became a confidential spy at Washington's urgent request and posed as a Tory. Despised by his wife and family, ostracized by his friends, he became a cattle buyer for the British Army. American soldiers were ordered to shoot him on sight, but John Honeyman kept his promise never to disclose his real identity. Once, he allowed himself to be captured, knowing he might be shot, but there was a chance of being brought before Washington first. This fortunately happened, and Honeyman was able to disclose to Washington how some of his own men were on the verge of assassinating him by placing poison in the general's food. And it was John Honeyman who, on Christmas Eve, crossed the Delaware alone, entered Trenton, discovered the condition of the Hessian troops, and reported back to Washington on the other side. On Honeyman's unsupported testimony, Washington made his celebrated crossing, won his celebrated victory that turned the tide. Honeyman returned to his New Jersey home after the war, still an outcast, still an object of hate and scorn. His magnificent services were never announced until Washington himself made a special trip to Hackensack and publicly proclaimed him one of the greatest heroes of the American Revolution. His example will always remain a shining light to Americans who seek to serve in the silent, secret, and sometimes inglorious ways of espionage. I thank you.
Thank you, Major. That's very interesting. Very interesting. Once again, The 39 Steps, starring Robert Montgomery and Ida Lupino, with Isabel Jewell and Gene Lockhart. It's early the following morning. Richard Hannay stirs restlessly in the armchair and rubs his eyes sleepily. Suddenly, he jumps from the chair and stands in the middle of the room, staring down at the handcuffs which are dangling from his wrist. Pamela Stewart, on the other side of the room, smiles cheerily.
Good morning, Mr. Hawkinson. Morning. Looking rather dazed this morning.
How did you get free?
Oh, very simple. A little matter of work while you had your nightmares.
I suppose you filed the handcuffs.
No, darling, I picked the lock. I was trying to do the same for you, but the file broke.
Say, what's wrong with you?
Oh, nothing that I know of. Oh, you mean my shoes. Yes, they're rather large, aren't they? I borrowed them from the innkeeper's wife.
No. It's not the shoes. Why are you being so nice? You don't feel ill or anything, do you?
No, why should I?
Why didn't you leave? You were very anxious, too, if I remember correctly.
Well, something happened last night that convinced me you've been telling the truth.
May I ask what earthquake caused your mind to work at last?
When I got free, I went downstairs. That car you said I imagined belonged to our pursuers. They were sitting downstairs when I got there.
Did they see you?
No, I hid behind the counter. But they asked the innkeeper about us.
What did he say?
He said he hadn't seen us. Then they ordered something to eat. And while they were eating, they talked a lot about the 39 steps.
39 steps?
Oh, don't ask me what it means, because I don't know.
Anything else?
Well, they said the professor was clearing out of the country.
Then he has got the secret. Did they say how soon he was leaving?
No, but they did say that he was going to London first to pick up someone at a music hall.
39 steps. London Music Hall. It doesn't make any sense. Which room are these men in?
Oh, they left.
When?
Oh, about 4 or 5 hours ago.
And you let them go after hearing what they said? Oh, you button-headed little idiot, you.
Don't you speak to me like that.
My dear girl, I'm accused of murder. The only way I can clear myself is to expose those spies.
Then why don't you go to Scotland Yard?
What's the use? You said yourself that no one would believe me.
Well, then why don't I go to Scotland Yard?
Why not? They'd listen to you.
Of course they would.
Come on, we'll get the next train for London.
You wish to order now, sir?
No, thank you. I'm waiting for someone.
I beg your pardon, sir. Your face looks familiar. Are you in the cinema?
No, I'm not. Bring me a bottle of ale, will you?
Very good, sir.
Oh, make that two, please.
Yes, miss.
Pamela, sit down.
Did you think I was never coming?
Not exactly, but I was getting nervous waiting. Well, what happened? Did you go to Scotland Yard?
Yes.
Well?
Prepare yourself for a shock.
Why?
They've checked every possible channel. The Air Ministry are positive that no papers are missing that will be of any possible use to spies.
But that's incredible. Are you sure?
Well, that's exactly what they said.
I don't know what to make of it.
I think you've been tricked.
Well, certainly is all very bewildering.
Oh, I'm sorry, Richard. Really, I am. Look, I think you better go now.
Go where?
Oh, any place. Leave the country. I'll help you.
You?
Oh, I know it sounds funny, but somehow I couldn't bear the thought of them catching you again.
Why, Pamela?
Oh, I don't know. I guess I've just changed my mind about you, that's all. Of course, you're as vain as a peacock, and I couldn't stand you for any length of time, but you're not so bad.
Well, you're not so bad either. If I weren't in this jam, I'd...
What?
Nothing. Come on, let's get out of here.
No, you better stay. I'll run and get you a ticket for Liverpool. There ought to be a boat train
Pamela.
Soon. Well, what's the matter? What are you staring at?
Look out the window. Do you see that billboard across the street?
Yes. Is there anything strange about it?
A list of acts playing this week at the Palladium. The feature attraction is Mr. Memory.
But I don't understand.
Come on, we're going to get out of here.
Well, where are we going
now? To the Palladium.
But why?
I don't know, but we're going just the same.
Here are your seats, sir. First two on the aisle.
Thank you. Sit down, Pamela.
This is silly. In the first place, the show's almost over. If anyone sees you here, what are you looking for?
Be quiet. I'm just playing a hunch, that's all.
Well, you're playing the fool if you ask me.
Ladies and gentlemen, with your kind permission and attention, I now have the honor to present to you one of the most remarkable men in the world. I present Mr. Memory.
Pamela.
What?
Look at that right-hand box nearest the stage. You see that small man sitting in front?
Why, yes, it's...
It's the professor himself.
You better get out of here before they see you.
No. Sit down. Listen.
Every day he commits to memory 50 new facts, and he remembers every one of them. Facts from history, from geography, from newspapers, from scientific textbooks.
Pamela. Yes. I've got it. I've got it.
What?
Don't you see the details of this Air Ministry secret have been borrowed, memorized by Mr. Memory, and then put back again before anyone could know?
Why, that's it. Of course it is.
Pardon me, sir, but there's a gentleman who would like to speak to you.
Who, me?
You, Richard Annie.
Well, I...
You're under arrest.
Wait, officer.
Preston!
Listen, there's something here you ought to know.
That'll keep, Annie. Come along quietly.
Yes, but you must listen to him. That man on the stage can...
Come on, we don't want any excitement here.
All right, I'll go quietly.
Richard, you're not.
Distance from Montreal, 1,400.
What's the use?
24 miles, am I right? Thank you. Question, please. Do not hesitate. Your question, please.
Wait a minute.
Mr. Memory, what are the 39 steps? Come on, answer up. What are the 39 steps?
The 39 steps. The 39 steps is a secret organization headed by Professor.
Moonsby,
shut up. The man up there in the box. He's the one who shot him.
Stop that man.
Stop that man. Stop him. Stop him.
I want to see Mr. Memory, please. Where's his dressing room?
Number 5, but you can't go in now.
Well, I'm afraid we have to. Detective, have you a pencil and a piece of paper?
Yes.
I want you to write down everything you hear.
But listen here, I
do as he tells you, please.
I'm going to prove to you that the man who shot Memory is the murderer of Annabella Smith.
What is it?
We want to see Mr. Memory. How is he, Doctor?
Very bad. Did they get the man who shot him?
Yeah, we got him, all right. He'll hang for it, too.
Oh.
Mr. Memory. Mr. Memory, can you hear me?
Yes.
Mr. Memory, there's something I'd like you to tell us, please.
Yes.
What was the secret formula you were taking abroad?
Will it be all right, my telling you? It was a big job learning it. The biggest I've ever tackled. I don't want to throw it away, sir.
It will be quite all right.
The first feature of the new engine is its greatly increased ratio of compression, represented by the formula 1 - 1/r to the power of gamma - 1, where r represents the ratio of compression and gamma dimensions of cylinders. Diameter. This device renders the engine completely silent. The exhaust gases impinging on a series, entirely eliminating all sound. Am I right? Am I right, sir?
That's quite right, old chap.
Glad it's off my mind. At last.
Memory. Mr. Memory.
Richard, what is it?
The Air Ministry's secret will never leave England.
This way, please. We can pick up the police car on the corner.
The police car? Where are you taking us?
To Scotland Yard, of course.
Scotland Yard.
Yes, but you can't do that. You heard what that man said. He didn't kill anybody.
Easy now, easy. He'll be all right. All we want is to put the story on the record.
Oh,
that's better.
You've nothing to worry about at all. He'll be a free man in her now, Mrs. Hannay.
Hannay? Well, what are you talking about?
Well, I... Oh,
Mrs.
I'm
Hannay.
Sorry. I thought...
That would be just fine, that would. We were together for one day. One day, and we fought for 24 hours.
20? You were asleep 4 hours.
Can you imagine what it would be like? Fight for breakfast, fight for lunch, fight for dinner. One long, drawn-out battle for the next 30 or 40 years.
Oh, 30 or 40 years. Do you think we could keep it up that long? I mean, really.
Well, we could try.
Robert Montgomery and Ida Lupino have completed the 39 steps, but they'll take a 40th when they return later to the microphone. First, a word from Melville Ruick.
Thank you, Mr. DeMille.
Just a moment for a suggestion to the women who begin when winter comes to be bothered by rough, chapped hands. Perhaps they don't realize that the trouble may start in the simple daily task of washing the dishes. Here's the reason. There are oils in your skin which give it a protective coating against cold weather outdoors and steam heat indoors. If you use a strong soap in the dishpan, these oils are dried up. Your skin gets rough and red. To protect these beauty oils, simply change from your harsh soap to Lux Flakes. Women find the difference between Lux and ordinary soaps for dishes almost unbelievable. They feel it the moment they put their hands in the dishpan. There is no sting in the very gentle, soothing Lux suds. Almost at once, your hands will begin to look smoother and whiter. Begin tomorrow to keep your hands lovely by washing dishes with Lux Flakes. I turn you back now to Mr. DeMille.
At the moment, both our stars, Robert Montgomery and Ida Lupino, are having a breathing spell between pictures. Bob is back after 6 weeks in the East. And Ida's been indulging in her favorite avocation, composing music.
And not just simple little ballads, Mr. DeMille, but the real thing. Not so long ago, the Los Angeles Philharmonic Orchestra played Ida's symphony, Aladdin and the Lamp.
Oh, thanks for the nice boost, Bob. You know, composing's really very exciting, although I had no thought of attempting it until 2 years ago. It was just about this time of year. I was riding in a taxicab down Hollywood Boulevard. The street was crowded with Christmas traffic. And all of a sudden, the noise seemed to take the form and tempo of a melody. Well, I rushed right home, worked straight through till morning, and there it was, and I've been at it ever since.
What's your latest composition?
Something I've just sent to London. The score and book for a musical comedy. Look, I hope no one's going to get the impression that I think I'm a great musician. In fact, I know so little that I often use a code to take the place of notes and musical symbols until I've time to figure out what I'm trying to do. I use the letters of the alphabet for a code. If you ever saw one of my scores, you'd think someone had spilled alphabet soup on an orchestration sheet. But I think our listeners are a lot more interested in what Bob's next picture is going to be than in my music. So, Bob, suppose you tell them.
Well, if I knew, I'd be glad to. I'm having story difficulties at the moment.
Don't we all? Can't you find the right one?
Well, the trouble is, I found the right two. And MGM and I can't make up our minds which will make the better picture. Number one is a light comedy, the type of story that audiences have been favoring so much lately. Plenty of laughs and sophistication. Number two, also a modern story, presents a definite problem of living that any one of us might have to face. A very interesting story for an actor, but the question is, will it interest an audience?
And in the meantime, you're first shot a fence, eh?
Exactly. And since that's not a very comfortable spot to be in, perhaps the Lux Radio Theater audience will help me out. I'd really be very grateful if you'd drop a card or a note to Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, to me, or the Lux Radio Theater, and let us know which of these two types of pictures you'd prefer to see. A light comedy, or a story with a social problem. In the meantime, my thanks and good night.
Good night, Mr. DeMille.
Good night, Ida. Good night, Bob.
Thank you, Robert Montgomery and Ida Lupino. Ladies and gentlemen, this is your announcer, Melville Ruick. Mr. DeMille returns in just a moment with news of next week's play and stars. In our cast tonight were Leonard Mudie as Professor Bartlett, Reginald Sheffield, Herbert Evans, and Keith Kenneth as detectives, Lionel Belmore as innkeeper, Vernon Steele as cart driver, Edgar Norton as manager of the music hall, Eric Wilton and Raymond Lawrence as Cockney travelers, Ward Lane as butler, Eric Snowden and Norman Ainsley as Scotchman, Sybil Harris as a rowdy, and Phyllis Coughlin as a woman. Louis Silvers appeared through courtesy of 20th Century Fox Studios, where he was in charge of music for the new picture, Love and Hisses. And now, our producer.
One of the most glamorous beauties of the screen that the screen has ever known appears in the Lux Radio Theater next Monday night. Marlena Dietrich. Our play is taken from the highly successful motion picture in which Miss Dietrich starred, The Song of Songs, the love story of a Viennese girl and the three men who tried to win her. Miss Dietrich will be surrounded by an all-star cast headed by Douglas Fairbanks, Jr., with Lionel Atwill. Our sponsors, the makers of Lux Flakes, join me in inviting you to be with us again next Monday night when the Lux Radio Theater presents Marlena Dietrich, Douglas Fairbanks Jr., and Lionel Atwell in The Song of Songs. The special guest of the evening will be the creator of Mickey Mouse and the Silly Symphonies, Mr. Walt Disney. This is Cecil B. DeMille saying good night to you from Hollywood. This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Some